What's up, people? Running a little late today, but it's all good. Thank you for tuning in, Talkin Shit with Kire. Today, my guest in the building is Coop C, and we're going to have a candid discussion about what's really plaguing the black community. So stay tuned, sit back, relax, get your favorite beverage, something to eat, chill. Hit us up in the chat box or call in at 323-900-0478 and voice your opinions and concerns or questions. Welcome to Talking Shit with Kire. What's up, Mr. Coop C?
Oh, my man. What's going on, brother? Good, happy Sunday to you.
Happy Sunday. Yes. Happy Sunday. Sunday fun day.
It is. Indeed it is.
So what's going on?
Well, running around SoCal. This traffic. Let's talk about how terrible this traffic is.
Oh, that's the worst.
It's the worst ever. Like, you know, I'm from Atlanta, baby, and I'm just like, what's going on here, man? Like, I can't get with it. But, you know, it's another blessed day, so... super happy, super, super excited to be on Talking Shit with Kire. You know, I like to talk shit with you all the time.
And, that's cool. You do.
Yeah. Excited to be a guest on your show here, brother. I appreciate the invite.
Yes, sir. Not a problem. Yes, sir. So, as stated, we're going to talk about what's really plaguing the black community.
Yes.
And I asked you to be the guest because I know the black community is something that's near and dear to you, just like me.
Indeed it is.
And we share a lot of commonalities when it comes to the black community.
Yes.
So I figured, you know, let's discuss some things. Now, some things we bump heads on.
Yes.
And we're going to discuss that, too.
And that's the beauty behind it. That's how you progress as a people. That's how, you know, we come together behind closed doors. We fight it out. We argue it out. But once we get out among the masses, if you would, then we have to share a common front, a common ground. That's mighty important.
Exactly. I agree totally. Yes. Agree 1,000%. So in the beginning, what I do is there's something called Tea with Kire, and we talk about different topics that's relative to the subject matter.
Right.
So okay, let's kick it off. So what I have first is
what we got. I know you have a list. We spoke about it last night. Part of the list.
Part of it. Yeah. Part of it. So I'm gonna go. Okay. Because one thing is, I think one thing that plagues the black community is like it's the how can I say this? A lack of black love is like dying out. You know, people are getting divorced. People are getting, you know, breaking up families and all this and that. So Teacher Campbell has a new song, and I posted on my Facebook page.
Does she?
I posted on my Facebook page. It's called 22 Summers, okay. And it's about, you know, she was married to Dwayne Martin for 22 years. So the song is not. So some people's like, you know, I don't like songs that. One of my friends, he's like, he don't like songs that.
Can she still sing?
Like bad. Hell yeah. if she didn't, I wouldn't be talking about it. He don't like songs that bash, but she's not bashing at all in this. The song is like, it's really empowering, and I'll say people, because you know men go through shit when we have breakups as well. So she's saying in the song, you know, she's found herself again. She's, you know, she's in a good space, but 22 summers, you know, of what she dealt with. Now she's coming back into her own. It's a great song. If you all like real music, and y'all who know me know, I only promote people that can really sing. If you can't sing, I ain't saying shit about you. So this song knocks, real talk.
I always beg the question, and it, clearly it happens. Like 22 summers, like why? What happened? You know what happened to where you lost yourself, or you came off kilter for that long of a period of time. You know, that's we never talk about it. We always talk about the comebacks.
Yeah.
We always talk about how we're winning, and now we're looking at good vibes. That's a thing, I guess, nowadays. But we never talk about prevention, if you would. You
know, okay.
Not dealing with not taking the bullshit up front.
But what now? Okay. That's okay, up front. Now you say that. Now she says she didn't say it's a song in the interview, but she was saying how the verbal abuse started in the beginning.
Uh-huh.
So what me would ask me is, well, why did you stay? Mm-hmm. Or what made you stay? What made you even say I do if in the very beginning this man is verbally abusing you?
Right.
Why would you stay?
Red flags are a thing.
Yeah. But sometimes I will say this, and this is speaking from my own experience. Sometimes we'll take the red flags and just throw them up in the air of, oh, fuck it, ain't gonna happen to me.
Wave off the flag with no flag on the plate.
And I'm just, you know, we just take the flag and throw it up in the air. Ah, it ain't gonna happen to me, whatever. But right, you're right. Red flags are something that we need to look at.
Yes, yes.
But sometimes we choose to ignore them. And that's men and women.
That's fair. It's across. It, you know, clearly it goes. It transcends race. It transcends gender. It transcends everything. I mean, it's human nature to see what we want to see. Right. But we have to live in the facts.
Okay.
Because people are dicks. Okay. And people don't have your best interest at heart, no matter what they say. You know, and if their actions don't line up to what they're saying, clearly you have to take care of yourself. And that's all right to be that selfish. That's all right to be that selfish before you have more responsibility of joint bills or babies. You know, it's okay. But no one talks about that. No one says it's okay to be that selfish.
Okay, so when you say selfish, break it down.
Okay. So if it's, you know, when you have relationships, interpersonal, friendship, you know, wife, husband, like, we know that you're going to disagree. You're going to butt heads. It's going to come a time where you're getting to know each other. Like, and people forget that the get to know you phase far outlasts the puppy love phase.
Okay.
The honeymoon phase.
All right. Far outlasts. Funny you said that. Because a friend of mine posted on Facebook, he like, it's funny, people are scared. No, not that one. No, he posted another one.
No,
he was talking about, right, not that one. No, he was talking about how the honeymoon phase, it dies out. And then what do you do then? My question is, why does it have to die? And in every relationship, does it die out?
I think it just, yes, hell yeah. It dies out. I mean, it's a new car, new relationship, new clothes. Everything loses its luster of newness.
Okay, so it loses its luster of newness. But now, okay, when once it loses its luster, what makes you stay, or does it make you want to go out and find something else that's new?
It depends.
Because are you in love? Because my question would be: are you in love with the person? Or are you in love with the feeling?
It can be both. It can happen at the same time. But that's when things, the rubber meets the road. The proverbial rubber meets the road. Like, does that person keep you in interested? You know. Were you just there for that sex? Because, you know, it ain't nothing wrong with falling into some sex.
Yeah, right? but let's make it understand that that's all we have is it's sex.
Sometimes you don't know.
Because like, one person is thinking that it's love, mm-hmm. and the other person is thinking that it's mm-hmm. sex.
Mm-hmm. If you don't ask these questions to yourself, you know, if you don't have that that self, how you feel about this self conversation. Then, I mean, and you haven't have an honest answer with you, you know, an honest answer.
Right.
Then what have you, you know? I get it. We don't want to hurt people's feelings. I get it. But shit, don't waste my time.
Well, now that I agree totally.
And I don't waste my time. I mean,
don't waste time.
Yeah.
So honesty is, to me, I've always said, the best policy.
Not everybody wants to hear the truth.
No, we don't.
No, that sounds good. It sounds good. Just tell me the truth. I can handle it. No, sorry, you can't handle the truth.
But how do you know a person can't handle the truth?
I mean, come on now. I mean, look.
Because I would rather you tell me the truth in the beginning and then for me to spend 22 summers thinking of something that's not.
Well,
for two summers.
He said 22 summers. That sucks. I mean, we're talking about two different things. Like, what we don't know his side of the story as far as did she lose herself because he pushed her to lose herself, or did she lose herself willingly? You know,
she said things like, you know, he would because her weight has fluctuated up and down ever since she had kids.
Yeah,
and, we saw that. We saw it on TV.
We
so he was saying that, you know, well, that's why you ain't getting no roles. You know, you're too fat.
That's so petty.
Some shit that's said, and it may be true, but it depends on who it comes from for me for it to affect me.
Yeah.
If I'm in a relationship with you and you say something hurtful, it's gonna affect me.
Of course.
If you just somebody on social media, you can say whatever the hell you want, so I don't give a damn. Yeah, it's not gonna affect me. But Yeah, that hurt. That's hurtful. So
she said she said took it in.
That's what she said. So of course, whatever somebody says to you that you care about, you internalize that.
Right.
And like she said, she lost herself trying to please him, trying to be what he wanted her to be. And it's easy to do that.
Yes, it is very easy.
Easy that.
It is very easy to do.
But like I said, yo, we don't know his side. No, we don't.
I mean, I'm just saying, she could have been a hellion.
She could have.
She looks stressful sometimes.
You know, you don't know. We all know what we see on TV. Now, I'm a huge Tisha Campbell fan. I don't know what it sounds like.
I have love for Tisha Campbell, but I see it in her eyes. She looks like she at the drop of a hat, bitch. I'm here to kick stress away.
I ain't gonna say that. Like I said, I love Tisha Campbell. I'm a humongous fan of Tisha Campbell.
Yes.
Actually, can I get her on the show? I love her.
Let's write her a letter. Dear Tisha. Dear Miss Campbell.
Yeah, because no, it's no longer Campbell Martin.
That's fair.
Okay, and then we're going to go to... Okay, let's go here first. Yeah, because I'm going to say that. The movie Harriet. Have you seen it?
No, I'm not. I haven't seen it. I don't.
You plan on seeing it?
I don't know. I don't plan on seeing it. Let me stop bullshit. It's just... it's not my thing.
Let me ask you now. What are your reasons for not seeing it?
I don't have any.
Because I done got knocked for not wanting to see it.
Like, I have no interest in seeing the movie. I just don't. It's not my genre of movies. I'm a huge sci-fi action guy. You know, Jason Statham. Like somebody has to get shot in the first 30 seconds. If not, then we're going home. Okay.
Oh, well, damn.
But somebody said, got to go.
But you said it's not your genre movie. But it's a movie about, quote unquote, about the hero named Harriet Tubman.
Well, true. The thing is, with me, it's weird. I don't like to watch things twice.
Okay.
I don't do reruns. It's just once I see the movie, I can watch Tuskegee Airmen, and I can watch Top Gun more than once. Over and over again.
It's the pilot in you.
But other than that, I can't do it. So it's like we read about Harriet. We know about Harriet. We dissected Harriet. You know, peace queen to Harriet. Get your $20 bill on. I support it. But it's like, shit.
I'm not going to do that. I ain't going to put on no $20 bill.
You know,
Trump ain't.
Not at all. But it's like, I can't. I don't want to sit through and be told a story that I already know.
Okay.
I mean,
but some things
hit me with a story that we don't know about. Let's talk about Mansa Musa. Like, we were talking about Marcus Garvey. Mm-hmm. You know what I'm saying? Let's have a biopic about Marcus Garvey, which they had, but it was supposed to come out last November.
Right.
But it just never came to fruition.
But let's have, this is my thing. If it's a actual biopic, let's have some facts and stop making up characters.
She did.
That's why I can't do Harriet.
Did you send? You sent me the link talking about the writer.
Yeah.
The writer said it would just be. It would basically it would just be cool to have a black bounty hunter. That's basically what it came down to.
Yeah. But wait, so I had people coming to me. You know how our people are. So you do know there were black bounty hunters back then, and there were black slave catchers. Yeah, I know that.
Yes.
But my thing is this: if the movie is about Harriet.
Right.
Let's see Harriet. Why are you making
this big
black man as the villain? And then here comes this white. So, see, people don't even know what they're watching. Because then here comes this white man who's secretly in love with her old master, from my understanding. And he kills the bounty hunter. If you haven't seen the movie, I'm sorry I gave it away.
Oh, no. You didn't even say spoiler alert.
Oh, spoiler alert. Yeah, I said it. So...
We're sorry, good people.
I'm sorry, if you were going to see it, you can still go see it because I don't know else.
That's not the climax.
Yeah, that's not the climax of the movie at all. You know, so he kills the bounty hunter, and to me, that shows that's the white savior complex.
Of course,
but now when I said that, people, there's no white savior in this. I'm like, you didn't hear what you just said because you told me that the bounty hunter was after Harriet, the white man killed him for her.
Yes,
to save her. The white savior. But like I said, a lot of people don't get and understand what they're looking at. And we're so used to accepting whatever Hollywood gives us And it's another thing I have a problem with the black community that plagues us. We don't, like Coop said earlier, we don't want the truth. You can't handle the truth.
Not at all.
But I don't know if it's that we can't handle it or we just don't want it. But we would rather be entertained. And so that's why people are gravitating to this movie. Well, and because I've had people tell me on Facebook, well, no, it's not all factual. You know how Hollywood does. Well, I don't want to know what Hollywood does.
I don't want to know how Hollywood does.
If this
does.
Movie was supposed to be about Harry, I want all the facts. I don't want no added characters. Like the character Janelle Monáe, that was made up. That she had no damn friend named Mary, at least not that I ever read about.
Historical fiction is a thing. Like, my goodness, the Willie Lynch letters. It sounds bad, but it's still fiction. It's historical fiction, right. You know.
But now I didn't find out until I was grown.
Yeah,
I never knew that. I was like, wow, oh, this is made up shit.
Yeah, it's some made up shit.
But it's true. But it's true. It's made up shit.
He said, oh, this is some made up shit. I mean, let's unpack one thing, because the theme of the show is what plagues the black community,
right?
And we can go around and around about the circumstances around Harriet, but the biggest thing is the lead actress, Harriet. She is, I don't know how they call it. She's English with...
she's a Brit. Nigerian Brit.
She's a Nigerian Brit. There we go. And apparently she has some disparaging remarks of
yeah, she doesn't like African Americans.
Hello. And that's annoying. Like, it really is annoying.
Now, like, see, for me, because people came at me was like, so one person that's a good friend of mine came, he was like, well, you're not seeing because of her comments and this. I said, my not seeing it has nothing to do with her. She can, in my opinion, she can feel how she wants to feel. She's free to do that, just like I'm free to feel like I want to feel.
She can feel how she wants to feel.
I don't give a damn about her not liking African Americans. That ain't nothing to do with it. My point is the movie's not factual.
For me, besides the fact that it's just not my thing to watch, part of it is one-fold. All right, it's not too factual. I can't be entertained by something that I know that's just you're telling me one thing, but you're showing me something different.
Right.
Shit doesn't add up. But then again, I have a huge issue with being this part of the diaspora, being African American, being a Negro. We oftentimes don't get the credit that we deserve for contributing to the diaspora the way we have, our ancestors have. I argue, and if anybody has a problem with this shit, come fight me. You know where to find me. Okay, I am Coop C. We can hash it out from there. I argue that, especially in America and across the world, if it were not for the civil rights movement in America, all right, if it were not for the civil rights movement in America, people of color all over the world would not be where we are. Okay, the civil rights movement.
I agree.
The civil rights movement during the late 50s and 60s and rolling through the 70s with Huey P. Newton, we got it. I firmly believe it set the stage for the ending of apartheid in South Africa. All right. You have to have a precedence, just like in law. You have to have a precedence for something, and we set the precedence for everything. So through that good, obviously we came from something. You know, we had slavery. We know the story of that, and so that's what is so irritating that people, not people, but the air is that the African Americans don't have a culture. You know,
okay,
that we don't have this and we don't have that. When in fact, I argue that we do. We push the stage of fashion, music, art. We develop trap art. Fuck.
I agree. So we're the innovators of everything.
We have, and that's not being an asshole. That's just fact. That's just the facts. You know you can't stop it. We started hip hop. Like you know what I'm saying? You go to South Africa and you hear how hip hop is infused in the clubs, you know? And they throw the African sounds into it, which is really dope. But you can't get away from the fact that we started hip hop.
True.
And people will soon forget that. I can't stand that. That's my take on that. I mean, she's gonna feel how she feels, but
right.
I don't think anyone really has tells anyone to shut the fuck up. Okay, like,
but then she's, well, and here's my thing. When they brought out her tweets from long ago, even though they were long ago, but, and I said it before, yeah, tweets, before 20, I got 20, into this 20, movie.
2013, I think.
2013 and 2012, yeah. Like Kevin Hart, when he brought out his, he apologized. Well, he apologized again because he had apologized way back when. She didn't even apologize for these tweets, which lets me know this is how you really feel.
And that's all right. I don't.
And that's cool.
I disagree with Kevin apologizing for that shit.
Yeah. Well,
you know.
The first time I wasn't against it because I'm like, okay, well, you say you're sorry to your fans. Come because you got gay fans. You know, hey, I'm sorry. Because some people, I guess, were triggered by their childhood. Whatever. That's why they got mad, which is...
And that's why they got
that's
mad.
Something else told, that's a totally different show. But yeah. But I got mad. But the second time he apologized, I was like, no. You apologized once. You don't need to keep apologizing.
Right.
You said, fuck him.
Yeah.
That's my attitude. Fuck him.
He said, fuck him. And that's what that is. We have this thing going on in society that everyone needs to be appeased. And again, No one gets told to shut the fuck up.
Right. And you can't appease everybody. That's impossible.
And we, you know, we spoke about this. We spoke about this yesterday on the telly that we spoke about that people are under this misconception that you have to agree 100% of the time with someone. And that's just not true. That's not how humans are. Like,
you exactly.
Politicians in business, you're not going to get that 100% solution.
Never.
You're not. And I don't think, you know, with society, that's how we're all divvied up into how we feel and into what sections that we are in. And we are expecting 100%. When in actuality, all you need is 70%. We can, for example, I hate to speak in and just arbitrarily have random thoughts. But our politicians, right? Mm-hmm. Like our politicians, or you know, we'll keep it linear. Our entertainers, Kevin Hart, right? Mm-hmm. Like he's an entertainer. That's what he does. He has personal thoughts. He lives in the same society we do, but he's not going to agree with 100% what you say. So that means you cancel him. Like,
right?
You cancel that, and President Obama had just spoken about how basically cancel culture is stupid. It is.
It is.
And going back to the theme of that this is what plagues us. And all that to me goes into groupthink. It goes into how we think as a people. Like we're not having independent thoughts. No one is saying, hey, wait a minute, this is dumb. Like, this is dumb.
Because if you do, then that's when people come against you and want to, like you said, if they don't agree with you, then that's when they really, really come against you.
Mm-hmm.
Because we're in the age of social media now, and people who I know personally have stopped being my friend in real life.
What? No, stop it.
Because I didn't agree. Because of the Bill Cosby thing and my stance on Bill Cosby.
What? Okay, 30 seconds or less. What was your stance on Bill Cosby? Because clearly I was.
He shouldn't have went to jail.
He shouldn't have went to
and
jail.
And most of them hoes was lying. And that's what I said, you know, fuck it. That's what I said. That's what I thought.
Oh, you know.
And then they used the testimony of one woman who in her book put in there, she tried to seduce Bill Cosby and he wasn't having it. He turned her down flat because she wanted to be on the Cosby show with Janice Dickinson. And I'm like, you taking the word. So this is what I said on Facebook.
She looks stressful too.
Janice well, Dickinson. Whatever she looked. I'm like, you took the words. This coked out hoe. Everybody know Janice Dickinson is coke. Coked out. You took with the coked out hoe, and she done passed out her pussy mold. Then the collection played at a mega church on Sunday mornings, mm-hmm. all four services.
But
you
all took four
this
services.
But you took this testimony and used it against this man who is 80 something now. And my other question was, why it take you 40 or 50 years to come out and say Bill Cosby touched me? And I said they were lying because I didn't believe most of them. Because even though Bill Cosby was who he was in the 60s, he was still a black man, number one, first and foremost.
Mm-hmm.
You had this white woman say that when they were backstage at Johnny Carson, she was in the dressing room. Bill Cosby just walked in. This white woman walked in, pulled out his penis, and put it on her lips and said, taste it. What black man got that much power in the 1960s to do this on white woman?
They still hanging Negroes in the 60s.
Listen, they killed a boy because this bitch lied and said he whistled at her.
Right.
But you let the black man put his penis on a white woman's lips? Stop it. And people were falling. But what killed me was our people were the ones falling for this bullshit. And like, y'all followed. I'm like, no.
It to me, it didn't make sense. None of it made sense.
None of it. And he's sitting in jail now.
He mad as shit. What? It didn't make sense.
But other people mad. But what'd you get out of it? You didn't get no money. You didn't get nothing. He in jail. So what? But a lot of black women were mad. And I said this on Facebook too. And I love my sisters. But some of y'all were mad because Bill Cosby, in your mind, represented Uncle Rufus, who touched you as a child. But even though he wasn't Bill Cosby wasn't no child molester, but it represented that because that's why a lot of black people were mad. Mm-hmm. And they wanted, you want this man to pay for what Uncle Rufus did. Rufus is dead and gone. Bill Cosby is the martyr. Is thing. Yeah, but Bill Cosby is the martyr. That's not right. That's not fair, my opinion.
He had to go. They said, well, he got to go. None of it made sense. None of it. So... What's next on your
list? Kanye West.
Here we go.
Well, this is going to what we talked about yesterday. Because we'll get into that. But Kanye West and his newfound religion. Now he canceled. Now he had a conversation. He did an interview. He was talking about how we don't have culture. But he said now after, shout out to Ashley. After I listened to the whole interview, I agreed with a little bit what he said. Because he said, we don't have culture because some things we give away. Some things we do give away. Some things we don't give away. Some things are just taken. But we're the innovators. But our shit has been taken forever. But to say we don't have culture, I totally disagree with that.
He's part of the goddamn culture.
Well, I don't know what's happened to Kanye. Because this is not the same man that said George Bush don't care about black people. That's not the same Kanye.
No, we know that. I mean, we've all seen it. We don't even need
His brain. Like, he was in the movie Get Out, and his brain has been...
We don't even need to rehash it. You know, after his mother, rest her soul, left this worldly plane, you know, he went left. And, you know, if Jackie leaves, you know, I don't know what I would do.
But, well, I agree.
But at least I would have the wherewithal. The people around me would have the wherewithal to be like, Coop, shut the fuck up. Sit your ass down.
Well, now he is.
Be quiet.
Well, now he is a born again Christian. And, you know, he's now taking stances against pornography and premarital sex. Cause, you know, he asked everyone who worked on the Jesus King album to not have sex.
He said that?
He talked about it. He asked him, you know, if you're not married, don't have sex.
He's true.
During this project, because he wants this project to be pure.
But that has nothing to do with it.
Well, it goes against Christian beliefs.
It does, but that
even though there's more Christians fucking than the law allow, but
fucking law allow. But that's the thing, like, and here's my inherent issue that people forget when it comes to you know, we spoke about it a few weeks ago that people forget with these religions, but we'll just use Christianity. Like, your walk with Jesus is your walk with Jesus, right?
Right.
You may want people around you to be saved. I get it, all right? Spread the gospel. But it has nothing to do with how you feel about Jesus, has nothing to do with anyone else.
True.
And that's not, I don't think that's fair. That's not right. To want to always project that, you know, I mean, speak your truth. Hey, Jesus did this for me, and if it's not for that person, you got to roll on. This is not the
yeah, but most, well,
it's not the crusades.
I was saying, most,
you're not gonna take me out because I didn't feel like reading the Bible today. You can't do that.
But most Christians don't want to hear that. Like, I've had people who I'm very cool with as Christians. Now, some things I post on Instagram. About, you know, Christianity, it'd be a meme or something that's against Christianity.
But it's funny. It's funny. It's jokes.
And it's truth.
But right, it's so funny. Like,
but this is what killed me, though. So each time, each person has said, well, what if I put up something about the LGBTQ community? I'm like, and my attitude is, do it. That's not my fight.
He said, do it.
I don't care. That's not my fight. But I mean, but people get so offended about what was given to us. That's not our thing. That was handed to us.
Yes.
Well, it was shoved into us and forced into us. And if people would study for themselves, they would know that. Because I posted our picture on my page. And so the boss man, shout out to Keith Good News. he put under his comment was, well, first of all, we think that Jesus is king. Let's start there, and which is true. Mm-hmm. That's what's plaguing the black community. That's mm-hmm. a part of it. Which is, I do believe that. That's a part of it.
Yes. Yeah, you know, let's tag on to that. I have a love-hate relationship with that ideal. I respected that. I truly believe that Christianity enslaved us. It aided and abetted in our enslavement, but at the same rate, it got us through it.
Okay, explain that one.
Okay, so you can't quantify someone's spirituality. We got it. Like, that spirituality is a very human, beautifully human thing. Mm-hmm. and the will of humanity is insurmountable. Like, you can't put a finger on our will as human beings. And with that being said, what gets people through that is their spirituality, you know? You know, their testimony, how they feel about Jesus, all this stuff. So slavery, what we know, was meant to break us. We were supposed to be enslaved for forever, but we were also meant to low-key not survive it, you know? On an individual level, we were not meant to survive slavery, but as a people, it was built for us to be enslaved for forever. Okay, I want to make sure that was clear. And Jesus, okay, got us through that. That's
well, the thought of Jesus.
There you go. Here we go. So the thought of Jesus literally was the only thing that got us through what was going on during slavery for years, generations, you know, right. until it finally happened. That paperwork was signed and
400 years. It took Jesus 400 years.
Right. And Juneteenth happened in Galveston, Texas, and we's a free people.
Yes.
And then we hit sharecropping. And then we hit Jim Crow. But but we weren't in shackles per se. We weren't in physical shackles. But so that's why. It definitely was used to enslave us, but it also mentally got our ancestors.
Well, you know what, and I was a Christian for years. But my question is, even for me back then, like, damn, I don't know why I didn't ever thought of this stuff, but how can they give us a God, we fall for it, and we pray to the same God in slavery, but this is their God they're praying to, for thanking him for making us slaves? So which side is God, and which side is Jesus on?
First of all, the dichotomy of the whole thing is laughable. It is funny as fuck. But again, like, it's you're asking a very logical question to a very illogical equation.
Okay.
You are. And that's where a lot of people, that's where that impasse happens. Like, because there is no answer for that. There is no answer. So of course, what is the Christian answer? You know, won't he do it?
The Christian answer is we don't question God.
There you go. Cause won't he do it? And we don't understand what's going on. Like, we don't understand his will. Got it. All right. Fuck it. Okay. And so that's where when I realized that was there, that you're asking logical questions for an illogical equation, I personally was like, you know, this isn't for me. You know, it's mm-hmm. not my thing to go out and tell people or try to prove people wrong, or let's talk about Egyptology. Let's mm-hmm. throw in Horus in there. It predates Jesus 5,000. No. All right, yeah, we got facts, but
that's where they got Jesus from anyway. Story of Horus.
This is true. But you know, whatever wakes that person up mm-hmm. and gets them through the day, as a productive right. citizen.
That's why I don't knock
right
it.
Without killing me, without coming where I am trying to shoot me up in the club. I'm okay with that. I'm good with that. You know, I'm cool. Like, don't come around me asking questions that you don't want to know the answer to now, because I'm going to give you every answer plus two more. Okay? I'm going to give you all what you asked for now.
I believe it.
But every piece of it. But I'm not about to go out of my way to dismantle your foundation. I don't think that's right.
Okay, I agree.
Not at all. That's not cool at all.
Like, I agree. But now, okay, so what... Because we did agree that Christianity is a part of what's plaguing us, then what part do you think plagues? And I'll say what I think.
It's so much, you know, the forgiveness part of it.
Okay, so you're going where I'm going. Go ahead.
Yeah, it annoys the living shit out of me. And
well, what are your thoughts on forgiveness?
And this is a way, not the way. All right, let me preface that.
I like that.
I am, I'm not the most. I disagree with that. Forgiveness. I'm forgiving you for me, not for you. Man, fuck that. Like, fuck that. Here's why. Because people do things. Humans do things when they do things when they know they can get away with it, and they know that there's no consequences to their action. Mm-hmm. You know, it's that small percentage who just don't give a fuck. We classify them as crazy. Got it. But when people think that they can get away with it and there's no consequences, they're gonna do come and go as they please. And but we're always seeking that. Please forgive me. I just want to feel better. No, like to me, that is we are. For lack of a better term, we're giving up our ghost. Like we're showing our hand. We're showing our hand. Like we're condoning bad behavior. I do not, whether it's kids or adults, I do not believe in rewarding bad behavior.
Okay, I can get with that.
Hell no, absolutely not. Like you know, kids, people fuck up. I'll say this and I'll be done. People fuck up. Got it. People make mistakes. Got it. I have a very low tolerance. I was just having this conversation the other day. I have a very low tolerance of adults who make intentional decisions. Okay, intentional decisions that are harmful to other people.
Hmm.
There's no forgiveness for that. Like you intentionally did that shit.
Yeah.
You know, you intentionally did that.
I'm with you all the way on that one.
Yeah, I can't because the intentionality is the bad part. You know, we can grow from I didn't know. We can grow from I think this was the best decision at the time. Like we can come back together. That shit pissed me off, dog, but we can do better, right? But for you to say, yeah, I intentionally did that shit. I mean, you know, whatevs. Nah, fuck you, homie. Like straight up, like, I don't have anything for you. And I firmly believe that when you have a cancer, you cut that cancer out. You know, and on another tangent, we're talking about in Christianity, you know, the Bible speaks to honor thy mother, honor thy father, and that leads to one other thing that plagues black people, I believe, is titles. You know, we give reprieve for people just because they have a title.
We do. Now that's true.
You know, true. Someone did some real fucked up shit, capital F, fucked up shit to you, and you. Oh, you know, it pissed me off and I'm upset and I'm sad, but it's okay. I have to keep them in my life because they're such and such. Well, no, player, the fuck you do. No, you don't. What are the second, third, and fourth order effects of keeping them in your life? Like having them have that access to you, you know.
All right.
Then you bring kids into the mix. You know, now you're leaving those kids open to the disappointment of what this other adult has done to you.
Mm-hmm.
You know, all because of a title.
I agree.
You know, and I just don't think that's right.
I agree. I'm not, well, forgiveness for me is, it's an either or thing. I mean, either mm-hmm. Either I do or I don't.
Now I have either I do or I don't.
Right. Either. I mean, I have forgiven some people, yeah. Who have hurt me? Because, like I said, it's my choice. I did.
Yes,
but my reason for forgiving that, I think a lot of Christians would forgive when, like, I go back to Dylan Roof, who killed those 9 people in that church.
Mm-hmm.
Like you said, an intentional decision.
Yeah,
he had pre-planned it.
He walked his happy ass in there talking about his own.
He pre-planned it, and so then at the end, the family member said, "We forgive you." That boy sat there and said, "I don't want your forgiveness. I don't need it. I did what I was going to do." He had sat there and told these motherfuckers, "I don't want your forgiveness." And they're trying to shove their forgiveness down his throat. But here's the thing.
You're going to take this goddamn forgiveness.
But here's the thing. And this is what I believe. This is a strictly what Kire believe. I ain't say this is the truth, but it's what I believe. I don't believe those people actually forgave him.
I think it's good.
It sounds great, and it's also, I need to go to heaven when I die.
Hello.
So if I don't forgive you, I can't make it in heaven.
Yes.
And I got to be with Jesus.
Yeah, Christianity is a thing of fear.
Exactly.
Let's be very clear about this.
You know, but I'm like, but
if now, you don't do this, and this if the
Bible
will happen.
Is, but if the Bible is right though, and you really don't forgive him, then you just told a lie. So you still ain't going to heaven. You just said it. Because God knows your heart.
I was just about to say that. I was just about
God knows your heart, quote unquote. So yeah, no, you're still not going.
So no, you're still not going. That's
man, that's truth.
That's so fair. I don't understand it. Maybe it's not for me to understand. It's just not logical for me.
Now you said you were you ever a Christian?
Absolutely.
Okay.
Absolutely. Like you know, my you know, we're from the South. My mother, she, you know, shit, she's a baby boomer.
Okay.
You know? So of course, you know, I'm a black man from the South. We're going to be Christian. We black. Like we're black. Let's not. It's memes about this shit. Let's not get misconstrued.
Well, but some people are just now getting into it. Now, I was born and raised Christian.
Yes.
And my cousins, I think they believed in God or whatever, but now they didn't go to church then. But I was a kid, a teenager, and young adult. I was in church every Sunday. Sunday school, church, Bible study, prayer meeting, blah. I was there.
Mm-hmm.
Now I'm not a Christian. Mm-hmm. I was there now, my cousin, everybody done found Jesus.
Yeah.
I'm like, okay, yeah, because me and one of my cousins who I'm no longer associated with, that's her thing. You know, she's found the Lord. Because we got into it one time. She's like, she found the Lord. She done found Jesus. I said, I didn't know the motherfucker was lost.
He didn't go anywhere.
So now I was like, now you done found Jesus and he's the way. Girl, whatever. Okay, fine. But it's a fear tactic. Very much so. I believe that.
Yes.
Because you don't do this, if you don't do that, you're going to hell.
Yes, this will happen.
Yeah, this is what happens. You go to hell and you'll be there forever.
I don't think that's love.
What is not love at all?
You know, but that's, you know, again, that's what wakes Christians up. You know, the Quran has its inconsistencies.
I think they won the same, my opinion, because the Quran, it just... T.D. Jakes said this one time, and I agree. And after I looked at it, I agree with him.
I love T.D. Jakes. I love that brother, Bishop Jakes. Like,
do you? I do.
As an orator,
yes,
he is amazing. Like,
he is,
like,
I get that.
I learned so much.
Now, one of my friends, she does not see it for him at all, and I'm like, but I love. I've always loved Jakes.
Yeah,
but she don't see it for him at all. But yeah, he is. He's a dynamic orator.
He is. His ability to lead people, to inspire people, is definitely a thing. It's definitely a thing to learn. And if you're not paying attention, then, you know,
keep
being the sheep that you are.
He's a leader now. Let's talk about leaders in the black community.
Mm-hmm.
Do we have any in today?
Man. So, you know, I'm tired of always needing a leader.
Oh my God, we're here. Yeah. Are we ever gonna disagree? Oh, we do disagree on one thing. We'll get to that.
Yeah, we'll get to that.
Yeah, we'll get to that. But
I'm so sick and fucking tired that we all. Who's gonna be the next leader? Like, and I get it on one part that we need a leader through every single phase per se from starting from the Middle Passage all the way to now. Mm-hmm. There's always been a leader emerging. You know, from Harriet, from Frederick, even if it's 2020 hindsight, maybe they weren't a leader at the time, but, you know, Brother Douglas, he was that leader. Then, you know, we started our at the time they weren't HBCUs, but we had a lot of talent come out of there. You know, Booker T. Washington, Hampton University, hello. And then we went into the teens, and then we went to the 20s. You know, We had artistic leaders. We had Langston Hughes, Roots of the Bros. We had all these people. I think a dynamic leader may be someone like Huey P. Newton.
Mm.
That's who I would say. You know what? That's what we need. That's a leader that we need. And alas, here we are. So going back to it, this whole we need a leader thing, it kind of pisses me off because we can never get on one page. So inevitably, we would discredit said leader time and time again. And we will repeat this cycle. You know, leader emerges, leader inspires, leader people disagree, leader dies. And we just keep on going through this cycle.
I agree, but when people who want themselves to be the leader, then we tend to find shit that's wrong with them and knock them down.
Right.
Like I always get knocked for saying this. I really like Umar Johnson.
Umar, where's the school, man?
Okay.
Where's the school?
We all got faults, but this is what I'm saying.
No, we ain't got no $1 million faults. $10 faults.
But I believe.
Okay.
But I believe he cares about. I believe the man cares about black people.
That's fine. But goddamn, Umar, that. Where's the school, bro?
Now I've asked that same question.
Excuse me. Here's what makes. Did they ever prove that he even has his doctorate?
Well, I know some people are trying to discredit him and saying he didn't, but they didn't prove he didn't.
All right, so for all intents and purposes, Dr. Johnson. For all intents and purposes, Dr. Johnson. I ain't going
to
tell you.
Is this something else we disagree on? Because you're trying to come for Umar.
I'm just stating the facts. Where's the school? Look, if LeBron can literally open this damn school.
Now, I said that too.
Okay, in a quarter of an eighth, a sixteenth of a time. When brother Dr. Johnson was peddling his school, and I don't know what to tell you, man. Like, you know, the facts just don't support your support.
Wow, you said peddling. You said peddling.
You know that brother peddling shit, man. Like, come on, dog. Come on, come on. He says all the right things.
Okay.
But he's not.
Okay,
not
so is that his only fault with you?
Absolutely.
Oh, okay, so
absolutely. Like that's it. Again, do I agree with 100% of the stuff he says? No, and that's all right.
I don't either. Right. But I believe he cares about black people.
This is true, and that's where we need to hold on to that agreement.
And I wish him. But what I don't like to see is the pan-Africanist. You know how they stay into it. Like that's not productive for the movement. Like him and
you know why?
Tariq Nasheed stay into it. Tariq Nasheed and Cynthia. Tariq Nasheed stays into it. Everybody.
You know why?
Why?
Because he keeps making money off motherfuckers, and they're mad.
Who, Tariq?
No.
Umar.
Yes. He's still peddling the same bullshit, getting away with not having a school and still making money.
Well, people send him money.
Exactly. So of course,
why are you mad at him? He's the player, not the game.
I mean, they shit.
Here's the player. I mean, what? It is what it is.
I can't. They. He's a false prophet. Let's just call it.
Okay.
What it is.
Okay.
Okay. He should have had his he should have had that school up and going. Great, amazing concept.
Well, now, okay, but now I'm gonna say this. You say he should have. Okay,
if not, at least have the receipts.
But for the type of school that he wants to build, he has to go through a lot of red tape.
20 years worth of red tape, dog.
It ain't been 20 years now.
Look, Google it. Somebody out there who is listening to our sultry ass voices, please Google this shit. Okay, because my phone is 10:30 and I can't reach it. Someone please Google how long Brother Dr. Umar Johnson has been peddling this school, and let us know on the good news, okay? Because we sitting here talking shit, and it's got to be 20 years.
Okay, I'm gonna go. I still got a little bit of juice on my phone. This charger worked last night. I just got this charger. Okay, Umar Johnson school, but it hasn't been 20 years. Okay. Stop it.
Okay, you may have to do some digging. Yeah, because 1999 wasn't too long ago.
Now, that is 20 years. Okay. but wait. What was it? 1999?
Absolutely. Absolutely.
You so funny.
Absolutely.
Now, okay, announced his school location. He announced the school location in February of this year.
Oh, did he?
Yes, this is right here. You told me to Google.
No, man, it's still grass where that school's supposed to be.
But what?
It ain't been no one bulldozer.
But like I said, for the type of school that he wants an all-black school.
We
all black, and we do have all black school to build for black boys. He wants to, I don't know if he wants to model after the one in Chicago, because then they have that's a great institution.
Right,
they have different ones around Chicago. They're the same. I can't think of the name.
He keeps trying to peddle. He's reinventing a wheel that has been invented and is rolling. Okay, as of today.
I guess, but it hasn't been 20 years. I ain't gonna do it to you.
That's more. Fine. That's fine. Because in your heart of hearts, you know that shit been 20 years. That's fine. You had to give me credit, brother. But just know, you know.
Now, if it's 20 years, hey, I give you credit.
No. You don't even. You keep that energy.
I don't believe it's been 20 years. 20 years. So 1999. Umar. Well, I didn't even know who Umar Johnson was in 99.
The guy.
I wasn't, I wasn't where I am now. In 1999, I was gung-ho for Jesus. If you weren't talking about Jesus, I wasn't trying to hear you.
If you weren't talking about Jesus.
But, Umar, I got love for the brother because he cares about black people. But he's knowledgeable. And I love now, Tariq Nasheed can say what the hell he want to say. But on that color, hidden color series, or at least volumes 1 through 3, Umar, to me, gave me the most information, the most knowledge. He kicked some shit.
Okay.
For me. Now, I haven't seen 4 and 5. I have to get those.
Yes.
But he's not in, I know he's not in 5. Is he in 4?
He's not in 5.
I know he's not in 5.
I haven't watched 4.
Yeah, because Tariq Nasheed, he put that out there like, I'm done fucking with you. His exact words. Yeah, so I knew that. And I was like, damn. I'm like, y'all just, if they would join forces, they would be, I think we would be much better together as a force, or they would be much better together as a force instead of apart.
Well, you know what? What's the theme of today is plaguing, what is plaguing the black community, right?
Yeah.
And you bring up another valid plague.
Okay.
We should have named these. We should have numbered them.
Oh.
Okay, we should have numbered them.
We'll do that next time.
Yeah, we'll do that next time. We'll have, talking shit. With Kyrie's countdown. Yeah.
I like that.
Absolutely. we don't have symmetry with our leaders. I'm using my air quotes, good people, air quotes, deployed, with our leaders. Okay. It's always a versus, all right?
Right.
It was Garvey and Dubois. It was Malcolm and Martin. And time again, we always say, if they would just join, if they would just come together.
Well, in the end, Malcolm and Martin were going to come together, but they killed Martin.
Man, we see, that's what I'm saying. Like, time is of the essence.
Right.
It is of the essence. Yeah, it's definitely of the essence. But I think this versus this with brother talking to him softly, Johnson. Okay, it's a black on black thing. It's, and go with me. Both of them support black people through and through, but with the other two that we use with Martin and Malcolm, both of them supported black people. Yes, but it was an element of let's still love and talk to these white folk.
Well, that was Martin.
Yes, and that's where the fundamental. That's the fundamental difference between the two. And then when you go back to the NAIA, NAACP, and you're talking about Marcus Garvey, you're talking about Dubois, and you're talking about how the NAACP was actually started by white people. And Garvey was saying, like, hey, we don't need that shit. Matter of fact, player, let's take our asses back to Africa. Okay? Let's do the Black Star Line. Let's do that. And we always have that element. I truly believe that it is definitely the post-traumatic slave syndrome. Mm-hmm. Which is a book, by the way. I
have that book.
Absolutely, I charge you all to go Kindle your lives away. And it's a thing. And I'll say this. It's not to rehash slavery over and over and over again. But it's very refreshing to now this day and age that we're unpacking the mental aspect of what it's doing. And that's what white people don't understand. White people think that we just keep bringing up slavery.
Yeah, they understand it.
No, I don't think they do. Okay. I don't think they understand that we're not talking about the shackles and the whips and the chains and handcuffs. We're not talking about that. We're talking about the you know, how redlining, or we couldn't get houses and how to build wealth. Why? Because, like, that's their life, you know?
Yeah.
You don't know a world without rhythm. They don't know a world without privilege. That's just a thing.
That's true.
It's just a thing.
But some of them will say they don't have her, like the ones
I don't even dabble in that argument. I don't
either, but
you know what I mean, with them.
I've said if you're white and poor, broke, yeah, I don't know. I don't see how, but yeah.
But you know, and it's crazy. Did you see American Son on Netflix?
Not yet. I'm going to. My best friend.
Are you serious?
I know, but you know what? I want to see it, and then I forgot. Right. And so last night, my best friend said, when you watch it, have your pressure pills next to you. Because my best friend knows me, and I will probably stop speaking to white people for a month after I watch it.
Have your pressure pills
next to you when you watch it.
I want to discuss it with you so bad.
You know, I'm gonna watch it so we can.
Yes, not even the whole movie. It's one part of the movie. And for people who have watched it, where the lieutenant had a conversation with the mother,
Kerry Washington.
Oh yes. I drink her bathwater.
I love Kerry Washington. Not to that extent, but I love Kerry Washington.
Yes, absolutely. But they had an interaction, and he was a dick. And when you watch it, you're gonna be like, he's a dick. But he was right. Like, he was so right. And I know you don't have, and I'm being very topical about it. Absolutely, because I, unlike you, good sir, I don't want to spoil it.
Okay. Well,
all right, I don't want to spoil it.
I didn't spoil nothing.
Yes, you did. You spoiled Harriet. You know what I'm saying? The white man killed the bounty hunter.
They can still go see it.
Now I'm sitting in the movie like, well, bring on the bounty hunter so he could die.
But if they listen to Yvette Carnell or any other YouTuber, you know, panelist, whatever, black YouTuber who talks about the people, then they'll, I guess, a spoiler alert. I sent you the video. Did you watch it? Yvette Carnell, the young lady, light skinned lady.
Yes. Okay. Yeah. Yes.
She broke down everything.
I was making my way through it. It was like an hour and 22 minutes.
Yeah.
I was trying to.
Get you got it. Yeah. You got.
I was trying to get my drink on.
Take it in sections.
Yeah. Absolutely. You said take it in sections. Yes.
But now, okay. Then going back to, you said Martin and Warren's with love white people. What are your? I think this is me because they're pushing this. They're pushing this so much, the interracial agenda. And I don't knock anybody for who you love.
Right?
Love who you love. God bless you. Or in my case, the universe. I mean, the universe bless you tremendously.
Yes.
But it ain't for me. I can't do it.
He said I can't.
And
do
I've
it.
Been knocked for. But and I see. But the, it's funny because the people who knock me are mostly guys that are from the South. And
why do you think that is?
I don't know. Like, I'm like, what is it like? Is the South like your, this mentality of the South? You know, we love white people. Because, okay, prime example. I'm in it's another social media group I'm in on this app called GroupMe. So I put in and I made a post, and it's a meme, and it says, black men are courageous, black men are strong, black men are valid, black men are, it was just giving black men a bunch of compliments. Why somebody come up to me with his black ass from Atlanta and said, well, what about white men? I said, well, what about him?
Wait a minute.
But first, the person who said it loves white guys. So I was like, well, what about him? He's like, well, you're not saying anything about that. I said, well, my job is to uplift brothers. I don't give a damn.
Right. That's not the conversation.
Yeah, that's not this. But that's also the same person who knocked me and said that I was racist. Which, by the way, black people cannot be racist. We that's another show.
That's just not.
Oh, we grew on that too. Look at that.
It's just a thing. That's stupid. So, that's just stupid.
But they called me racist because I said in the group, because they're talking about interracial dating, and I said, well, I can't. Mm-hmm. And so a white guy asked me.
You said I can't?
Yeah. So a white dude asked me, what's wrong? I said, there's nothing wrong. I said, I don't like anybody. I said, I have family members who mm-hmm. have white spouses and mates. I said, and that's for them. But for me, I need someone who I can connect with, who understands my ploy and I understand his. And we have that connection. Like, I know what it is to go outside. Because when you go outside, the first thing they see is your skin. So you're black first, period. Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm. And I need someone that can understand it. If I come home to Jim Bob, Jim, after a day of...
Jim Bob.
I done been racially profiled, which I have in my life. I've been racially profiled. I done been called all types of niggas. Jim Bob, I'm not going to understand that. Mm-hmm. Well, just ignore it. You know you're not one, period. That's what he's gonna say. But if I get this brother, he understands the plot. You know what I'm saying? He can be there, you know, really for real, comfort me in this. That's just me.
It's the truth.
Right.
It definitely is the truth.
But also, now this is what I think when it comes to interracial dating or marriage. I think some people are naturally attracted to white people, and that's cool. Mm-hmm. But I also believe a vast majority are not truly attracted to the person, but they're attracted to what they feel is the stat. Yes.
Yeah,
because for some odd reason we view white as the prize. Mm-hmm. We view them as the winner. I won.
That plagues us too. You know how I feel about black people pandering to mainstream America.
Exactly. Well, I won. I got this white woman. I won. I got this white dude. I won. No, and another thing why I can't do it because, and that's just me. I believe that if we get into an argument, he gonna use the N word.
And I don't know America, black America. Let me just say this publicly. Somebody come save me at that ever. Okay, I'm not going to put myself in that position, but that is definitely an apprehension of mine.
Well, and I said it only because I have, I have turned down some white dudes and have been called that because I turned them down. Well, what? Well, wait a minute.
Well, how does that work?
Listen. I'm like, well, wait a minute. So all of a sudden now I'm a nigger because I said no.
Mm-hmm.
Wow.
Mm-hmm.
So yeah. So, but that's a part of that privilege, and you know I can have anything I want. No, you can't, because you can't have me.
No, you can't, because right. You can't have me.
Exactly. No. And I'm not interested. And I mean, now don't get me wrong. There are some attractive white people. I would never say that they're not. But I'm just not. I just can't do it. I just can't do it. I mean, there's some beautiful white women.
It's beautiful white women out there.
I ain't going to say it like that, but.
I mean, it definitely is.
But because the most beautiful woman on the planet is a sister.
This is true. Absolutely. I always find it funny how beauty is modeled to some extent after black women, after these sisters out here.
Exactly.
But then when they do it, when sisters do it, it's like. It's overlooked. It takes, you know, what was that we were conversing about as far as the bonnet?
Oh, yeah, the bonnet.
That white woman was selling bonnets for $95.
We can get her. Oh, my God, I can't believe she came outside. And it's another thing with us. I don't have a problem with a sister. If she want to wear a bonnet, rock a bonnet with her outfit, baby, rock, do you?
I know. Hell no.
But,
fuck no.
But wait a minute. Let's see what show I'm going. Because then you have people say, well, why would she do that? I'm a guy. Okay, who are you trying to look good for?
It's.
I think that falls in line with white acceptance.
No, I'm just old school with that. Like, even if you come to my alma mater, at my HBCU, you couldn't walk around with, the boys, we couldn't walk in public spaces without do-rags on or a wife beater.
We good neither.
Yeah, it's just not a thing. It's a
where you go?
Hampton, the okay. Hampton University. Hello, the real HU. If someone has a problem with it, fight me. You know where to find me. I said it.
Okay. I ain't gonna say it because I love the other HU.
That's fine. That sounds amazing. You know, Howard has done a lot for the people. Howard has I've never gone to schools.
I've never visited Hampton's campus.
You should.
I've been on Howard campus.
You should come visit our peninsula, our home by the sea. Come on through. All right, and put your seatbelt on it to be amazed. Okay. See where the standard is. Sometimes you just got to go see where the standard is.
Now, Wilberforce wasn't, you know, we was great.
Hey, you know, I fuck with Wilberforce.
You should.
I do.
The first black university.
Yeah, I fuck with Wilberforce. Yeah. Colonel Charles Young. Okay, sure. Yeah. Okay. Yeah, all day long. What's up with Ohio? Did we play Wilberforce? I think we played Wilberforce my freshman year in the Circle City Classic.
And y'all probably played Central State.
Yeah, there we go. It was Central State. Yeah, we didn't play Wilberforce. Okay. Okay, there we go. Either way, we beat that ass.
My school's old. Hey.
At any rate, I don't have a dog in this race. I wasn't raised that way. I'm not passing like super judgment. I just don't understand it. Like, some things are meant for the house. Some things are meant for home.
Mm-hmm.
You know, and just because we're normalizing it, I mean, yeah. Oh, you know what? Let's talk about that. So, you know, what was that? A year ago, two years ago. So the down in Texas, they had the principal. She wanted a dress code for the parents.
I saw that.
You saw that?
Yes.
Right? And people were up in arms about it.
Oh, my God. They went off.
Right.
But then when I saw how the
parents were dressing.
Look, I was like, oh, well, maybe you should.
Yes. Yes. Absolutely. Like, people, like in this day and age, what ticks me off is, like, we have no standards. Standards are out of the window. Like, we just, if I feel like I can do it, I'm just going to go do it. It's like, no, bitch, sit down. You can't. Why? Okay? And that is the fundamental difference between our society now, generationally, and what it was before. We all have problems, you know, generationally speaking. You know, it's society. Through society, we have our issues. You know, back in the 30s and shit, yeah, they had standards, but they also had 10 families.
Right.
You know what I'm saying? Like, it was cool to beat your wife. You know, like, it was straight. Like,
was it cool or was it just accepted?
Nah, it was cool. You need to shut your wife up, man. You need to go put a hand on her or something. You know, that was acceptable and cool. That was all right. That was a show of force, a show of manhood. And we know that that's just
manhood to beat your wife.
Yeah, that's just idiotic as fuck.
Totally.
And so, yeah, that's. That be presentable. I'm all about it. Just
okay, be presentable. Well, yeah, because they showed the people on the news, and of course, when they showed them, they were all black. I was like, okay. And I saw bonnets, and I saw nightgowns.
Nightgown. Come on, bro. Like
at 3 o'clock in the afternoon.
Come on, man. You have no couth, and you got mad because someone told you didn't have any couth.
Well, yeah.
No. It doesn't work that way.
So, okay, well, with that being said, who are we trying to impress?
You know, it's let's impress ourselves. Okay. Let's have a standard for ourselves. This is what we don't do.
Okay.
You know, winners have standards.
Granted.
Right? Winners have a synergy. Winners have a work ethic. You know, as a team.
Love that.
You know, this is just what the fuck we don't do. And that's the privilege of winning. And we need that.
Okay.
You know, we need that.
What is the standard? What should the standard be?
Goddamn, be presentable. I mean, okay. My unrealistic standard is I'm a shirt and tie kind of dude. I am. You know, it's a thing.
Right, which I'm shocked today.
I told you I didn't feel like it. I hobbled. I just, I'm post surgery, y'all, for my little knee. And, you know, I just did not feel like putting on, I just did not feel like putting on pants today. I have pants, so I have shorts. Right. But, yeah, no, like, goddamn, be.
Be presentable.
Yeah, walk out the house like you actually gave a damn.
Okay, now.
And on top of that,
would you have on now? Would you pick your child up and drop your child off at school?
In my athletic gear, yeah, because it may be times I may come out of the gym.
Okay,
this is what I wear at the gym, but then we also have to realize, like, we're like, just how your child represents you, you're representing your child.
I agree with that.
You know you are. So
yeah.
So, I mean, damn. Do you want to know? Do you want your child to be at school and be known as the child with the parent that's ghetto and doesn't give a fuck? But you know, at the same time, if you don't care, you don't care.
I ain't gonna say they don't care.
Sometimes people, yeah, just.
And sometimes people don't care.
Yeah, they don't care, man.
You walk out the house like, because I see some people, I ain't gonna say women, people, out in these LA streets. I'm like, the hell?
Basically. So, I think the last point that you wanted to talk about was.
Here we go.
Oh, yeah. I'm just saying, the last point that you wanted to talk about was black people in the military.
Yes! Well, I just want to know why.
Why not?
Why would I fight for a country that still in 2019 considers mm-hmm. me to be one third of a man? Who don't care about me? Who treats me less than human? Who care about animals' lives more than my life?
This is true because, you know, these white folk love their fucking dogs.
I mean, you know what? Now, I'm not even going to knock them for that because I love animals. I love mine. You know, well, when I had a pet. I had a pet. Yeah, when I had a pet, yes. I love
I'm still animals. Mad what they did to Michael Vick.
Listen, and they're still coming at this man.
That good sir.
I'm like, when y'all gonna let this go?
But we forgiving these white folk killing us in churches and shit.
Listen, we forgiving folks for coming in our goddamn house, our brother's house, and killing us. And killing them.
Yes.
That just burned me.
Kyrie, if some shit ever happened to me like that, I swear to goodness, I will scour this earth as Casper, the unfriendly coop ghost. If you go hug somebody after they done killed me, after they had the luck, the everything, the Rubik's Cube lined up to come for Coopsie.
I told my family members, listen, if somebody did that to me, and one of y'all told me, I forgive you. Jesus, I'm going to come back and haunt your ass every day.
I'm
going to
pee on you. I'm going to come back and pee on you.
I'm going to haunt you every day.
Like, not at all.
But yeah, but I can't. I just want to know why.
The thing is, it's actually multifaceted. You're looking at it from one position of why would you fight for this country.
But
it's all about opportunity.
Okay.
Sometimes the military is the only way to get out of your circumstance. And the thing is, if you don't look at it as such, then you get caught into the system, per se. And then on top of that, it's still your country. This is still, believe it or not,
no, it, I mean,
this is your country.
No, it is.
Yes. We're a land full of immigrants. No, bitch, we're not. Okay, we're not a land full of immigrants. I would like to say this publicly. We are not a land full of immigrants. We're not. Okay, we are a land with immigrants in it. Okay, but my lineage didn't migrate. Okay, to America.
Right.
So that sounds amazing, but it's just not the truth. And but moving on, this is still your land. This is still where you are. And on top of that, so in the military, as a leader in the military, sometimes these kids, if they in high school, let me just set the stage. In high school, for them to come out of high school, right?
Mm-hmm.
They're going to be successful in high school. We know that either you're going to go to college, you're going to go to a trade school, or you're going to go to the military. It's going to be one of the three. Generally, unless you stumble upon some shit, you start a business, like generally for just period. Those are the three avenues people take to launch themselves into adulthood, right? And a lot of times, college is not an option. They don't know what trade they want to do. And even then, it's still barriers to entry to those two avenues. Well, shit, if you run fast enough, and you don't have any issues, you can sign your name right here. Boom, you get a check. All right, you get fed. All right, you get the benefits. You get your GI Bill. All right, okay. You get your VA loan. God bless the VA loan. Okay. All right, and we're not being openly redlined anymore. All right, as far as housing is concerned.
Okay.
You know, because we know realty is a major key. It's a major path to wealth. Right. So it's a good start. So you're looking at it, why would you fight for this country when in fact, it's your country to fight for. You're not going to. Because here's the thing. Our enemies don't give a fuck about our racial issues.
Not a one.
They don't. They see an American. Now, sometimes you go to the Middle East, they do understand, like, hey, you're black. And they'll ask you. Like, even history tells us, even in Vietnam, they would ask the black servicemen, like, why the fuck are you here? You know? Because our racial issues are worldwide known.
Right.
It's not a secret that America was founded on racism. And but at the same rate, you are not going to go. So if I'm going to go, we still have to be represented. Representation matters.
Okay.
Because it's going to be some child who looks like us who has no choice but to go. That's the only way they can get out of the situation. You know?
It's through the... Okay.
And so I've been in, and it actually happened. You know, I talk that shit, and it sounds amazing. It sounds good. But I've been in situations to where there was a white service member who did... Do you have a white service member and you have a black service member, right? And the time difference was maybe a month or so, whatever. But they did the same thing, right? One got in trouble for it, and the other one didn't.
Well, I always say, we can't do what they do.
This is true. But guess what my black ass in the room was saying? Oh, hell no. Y'all can all kiss my ass. This is not about to happen. Okay? It's not going to happen. Everybody was in agreement. Yeah, he did this, little black kid. He did this and they did that. Well, we need to hold him to the standard. Well, fuck your standard right now, because you didn't hold this.
Well, yeah.
You didn't hold this one to that standard.
Billy didn't get held to the standard.
Not at all.
But Jamal will.
And not at all. And
but
so,
all of a sudden, they have a standard because it's Jamal.
This is true. And that, on that leadership level, you need that representation.
Okay.
And then for me personally, the job that I wanted to fly jets. I like flying shit upside down, and I like that. That's my thing.
And that's cool.
You know? So in the civilian world, you have to have a lot of privilege to do that, to financially back that. Mm-hmm. You have to have a lot of privilege.
So you joined the, you're in the Air Force?
No, God no. Hell no.
Oh, my fault.
Oh, no. I'm a Marine.
Oh, shit.
Absolutely.
Now, see, now you just taught me something. I didn't know Marines flew shit.
Absolutely.
I thought it was just the Air Force.
Everyone does. Don't. The Air Force just got here. They just got here in the 50s. Okay? They were part of the Army. Let's be historically accurate. So that's why, why would you fight for a country? I get it. I really do. And back in the day, I think this conversation was more prevalent. It was much more prevalent in World War One, in World War Two, when it was clearly like, fuck you niggas over there. Like, y'all really not gonna get none of this shit. Like, that's when the conversation was highly prevalent with the Montford Point Marines, with the Tuskegee Airmen, you know? But I argue, look what that did. Look what that did for me. You know, those are my pro fights. You know?
Yeah. I mean, open some doors for you, yes.
Yeah. You know? And the thing is, we know this, and I'll say this. We know the military gives opportunity. Military also provides a certain level of privilege.
Mm-hmm.
You pay taxes. I pay taxes. We fund the military. Why the fuck would we not take advantage of that?
Okay.
You know what I'm saying? Well, why not? Mm. You know, and you got these kids coming out of the military, and they're taking advantage. If they do it right, they take advantage of their you do this shit right, you can get halfway through your doctorate and not pay a dollar.
Now, that's dope. But college isn't for everyone.
This is true. You don't need that. I look, y'all, I'm a proponent of going to somebody's college. That's me. My nieces and nephews, I'm kicking stress to them. Go, you taking your black ass to Hampton University. But at the same rate,
but what if they're not college material?
You know what? That's fine.
Because see, that's
but
one thing.
You can still get your trade on.
Well, now, okay, no.
You can still get your trade on.
Well, okay, where? Because going back to Umar Johnson, that's one thing he said that I agree with.
Uh-huh.
They took away the trades and gave us college. They put it. It was like,
but not everybody can be white collar, and it's not a problem to be one or the other. You know, you do your thing.
It's really what makes you happy, but you just have to have something. And right. We speak about like the talented tenth, right? Dubois spoke about the talented tenth, mm-hmm. and he speaks about that. We basically need, you know, the top 10% of everyone's race will lead their race to prosperity, basically. And with Brother Dubois, he was bringing us together with that. You know, we talk about the talented tenth, and we talk about what is it and does it exist? Absolutely, mm-hmm. it does.
Okay.
That's just a thing. But he also said was that we need everybody. We need the scholars just like we need the welders.
Now, how do we bring, for us, everybody together?
I think the system that we had before this everyone go to college kick was just fine. You had wood shop. You had metal shop.
I took that in school.
Yeah, you had
driving. But they don't have it no more.
Yeah, you had home ec. You have basic things, mm-hmm. that these kids aren't getting.
Nope.
And that is also another issue that is plaguing black people. You know, we went and the thing is, let's put this into context. It's not, we can't villainize the process of that. We can't, because this whole kick into going into college, go to college, came about because we weren't having that much of an opportunity to go. So we kind of just over pushed it a little bit,
mm-hmm.
you know. And in society, what I have observed is, you know, when you're trying to push for one thing, you take from something else. You're taking from it, and that is the inherent issue with things. Whether it's with gender politics, whether it's politics, whether it's money, you know, money-wise, economically, who do we tax? Somebody has to get taxed. So we tax more over here. We're gonna tax less over there, and it's always this fight. Just because you want everyone to go to college, yes, push pedal your college, but at the same time, don't take away from the trades.
Right,
because electricians that make $150,000 in a heartbeat.
Yeah, that's a good trade, but. Like I said, everybody's not college material. Everybody's mm-hmm. not electrician material.
Mm-hmm.
So you have to decide and know what it is that you want to do.
But at any rate, this is true. But at any rate, it's going to cost you something to get into whatever school to learn said craft.
Yeah. Well, it depends on the school. And you can get some grants or whatever.
That sounds good.
As I say, if you can.
But if this little motherfucker can't even write their name, because you know they don't teach. You know they don't teach things like cursive in schools anymore.
I heard that.
It's the truth.
I'm like, what the hell?
It's definitely the truth.
That's awful.
I've seen it firsthand. Okay. Like, sign your name. I don't know how. I was like, oh, bitch, you lost your mind.
That's awful.
Yeah, you've lost your mind.
You don't know how to sign your name.
No, it's the thing.
There are people out here that don't know how to write in cursive.
Yes, walking this earth right now. Yes. Yeah.
Where have I been? I heard that, and I'm like,
yeah, it came out of the curriculum, and that is another thing that is plaguing the black community that our schools. You know what? I argue that it is plaguing society. It's plaguing America that our school curriculum is test driven.
Instead of
life skills,
we're getting the most brunt of it because. Every time they do something to a school, they always shut our schools down. Our schools are always overpopulated. Our schools are always, you know, considered to be underachievers. You know,
yeah.
We don't have enough textbooks. We have too many people in the classroom, not enough textbooks, not enough teachers. So, like, what do we do?
Mm-hmm. That's the thing. We know that.
That's something that's plaguing us. But I think one thing we need to touch on. I think we plague ourselves with our attitude.
Yeah.
And how we are so against each other.
How are we against each other?
Like, the slightest thing would divide us. Okay, for instance, yesterday with the movie Harriet.
Listen.
We're divided. You know, some people want to see it, some people don't want to see it, some people are not supporting it, they're not supporting it. So then I had somebody come to me, tell me, you know, with your black argument. You know, you should want to support. This is a black movie, so you just said forget the black writers for the black cast and the black this and black that, and you're not going to support it.
Black is okay. Let's just say that.
Now, how about that?
Can we just say that?
Hell, you can say it.
Goddamn.
As pro-black as my ass is, I'm going to say it. Yeah.
Absolutely.
And just because you're black, I'm not going to support it just because it's black.
Right.
If it's not good black.
I'm just not going to publicly berate you. I'm going to keep my ass in my house.
Right. And I'm just going.
And I'm just going to be.
I'm going to shut the hell up.
I'm going to drink my libations.
Right. Well, if I drink my libations, I might publicly berate you.
Right.
So... Coop is gonna drink his libations and be silent. That don't work for Kyrie all the time. So
you got a whole show.
And I'm just being real,
talking shit with Kyrie. I'm going to the studio. Oh shit!
Right, drunk as hell. So that divide. You know, we're divided by that. One thing I hate to hear people say is, I don't support black businesses because they just overcharge and they overrate and they do this and they do blah 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 blah. I never heard anybody say I'm not supporting the white business. But we'll say I'm not supporting the black business.
You've heard that?
Yeah, I've heard it. You never heard that?
Nah, man.
Wow, really?
It's crazy.
Yes. I have.
That's crazy. I mean, I definitely believe it. Like, people don't understand commerce. You know, people don't, like, if I can just go to Walmart and get it done. Like, and that's the thing. Like, we don't, you know, after desegregation and our neighborhoods, clearly where busing happened and, you know, we were just always trying to get into white spaces,
mm-hmm.
for lack of better words, because that was the better space. But what we lost, that was the better, relatively the better space because of better opportunities. White people just had better shit back in the day, right? But what we lost with that is our sense of togetherness.
Right.
We lost that. We lost that. If I see this black man on the street, like, if anything happens right now, I'm going to have to rely on that motherfucker. I don't know him, but I'm going to have to rely on him just by decree of our melanin.
But we don't have that no more.
It's around. It's around.
Far and few between.
This is true. But you know, because we have this no new friends attitude. I need all the friends I can get.
What is that about? I've heard people say that.
Yeah.
I don't need a new friend. I'm too old for friends.
Yeah.
Okay.
Whatever, dog. Friends are cool.
Okay. I like friends.
I love friends. All right.
If they're a real friend.
Right. Friends bring you liquor.
Your real friends will bring you.
Absolutely. So that we lost that sense of togetherness, and alas, here we are. You know, we're not relying on each other. We're not. How in the world? And I present this, and I'll say this. I know because we're running a long time. We talk about the Black Wall Street.
Yeah, we did. Yeah,
with zero technology. All right, with nothing, they started Black Wall Street.
Mm-hmm.
All right, I argue some people couldn't even read, maybe, but they started Black Wall Street in Tulsa, Oklahoma. It's 2019, and we are struggling.
We still ain't rebuilt.
We can't do it. We can't do it.
You think we can or we're not?
We can't do it.
Why we can't?
Because first of all, it'd be too much like right, and. There is not that sense of I'm gonna do this for the people.
Now, how do we get back to that attitude?
I think it's lost, man. It's lost. People are selfish as fuck. People are selfish, and two, society, the environment breeds selfishness. And until something catastrophic happens, we will remain selfish. And that was that's actually a conspiracy theory with 9/11. All right, what brought America together? 9/11.
Yeah. All right. Well, I'm not gonna say that. Okay.
But it did.
Yeah. No. It did. Now, I was gonna say something else, but no, it did.
You know. It, you know.
I just think something.
That's something. But if we look at it just on a topical level, American flags were selling out. You know, everyone was patriotic. Everyone, enlistments were up. Commissions were up. No one gave a fuck about paying taxes. Like, cool. Economy was booming because we were buying it. That bitch better say American made. All right. Ford had a record sales. Chevy had record sales because we getting American muscle. Right. Not me. I'm all about that Japanese shit, personally.
Okay. Oh, but yeah. Now you want to go to Nissan and.
You goddamn right. You got that. So that's just that. Like, we can't, another thing that plagues us as black people, white people know that about us. They know that we will be upset. We will be up in arms about us being killed in these streets by these police officers. We know that. They know that.
Yeah, yeah.
But then they also know that we will lose steam. They will also know that. All you got to do, it's just a matter of, hey, the black folk over there mad as fuck. Oh, all right. Well, just give them time. They will just give them time or give them a bright, shiny ball to the left and they will.
Yeah, the latest, whatever, the latest, whatever it is.
And it would be all right.
Oh, God. I want us to get up out of that mentality.
This sounds amazing, but
It does, but I'm serious.
And I'm with you. And I think we need you. We need that. Because my black ass is over here like, I've all been giving up. I'm over here like, man, it's not going
to
happen.
See, and that's what a friend of mine said that I was talking to him about this because he's like, he's the one who actually like started me, well, pushed me along further on this journey. You know, like after I had got rid of Christianity a couple of years ago, it's just like I just been like really pushing, you know, the black agenda because I see what they're pushing and I see how it's really affecting us. Even though a lot of people, I don't know if they don't see it, they don't want to see it.
But it's not new. That's my.
But that's right. It's not new. But it was like new to me. It's like I had this awakening. Like, damn.
Right. It's not like
I've been asleep like a motherfucker.
Right. And that's all right. But we have the '90s, Kyrie. We had the fucking '90s.
In the '90s, you know what I was doing? Partying down.
I'm with you, but as you should have, because Freaknik was still jumping in Atlanta.
Exactly.
Yes.
That's when it was fun.
Yes.
The early 90s.
But we had that. We had our TV shows. We had UPN. You know what I'm saying? Like, we were at
the 90s, we were at the top. We had, I mean, Living Single, which was my absolute favorite show, along with Golden Girls. And the 90s were everything. For me, that's the best era of music. You know, that's like, the 90s R&B is like the soundtrack to my life, basically. And, but it's like, after that, what happened?
That's a good question. Somebody write us. Somebody tell us.
Some of us want to recapture it. Some of us don't give a fuck. And some of us just. But like you said, I ain't gonna say all, but a lot of us have just cut everything off. Don't care.
It's just.
But that's something else that plagues us, not caring.
We become very short-sighted. As a society, we have become very short-sighted. Instant gratification is up. You know, we if it's a fad, it's a fad. You know, let's go with the fad. Let's go with what's new. Let's go with what's quick. And our issue as black people in this part of the diaspora is not we're going to have to demand things. We're gonna have to say fuck you to a lot of white people. We are to a lot of white
people. But we're scared.
This is true. We're gonna have to say fuck you to the establishment. We're gonna as a whole, you know. But not only that, it's gonna have to be these actions. Like we're gonna have to hit these pockets, you know.
Oh my God! Exactly. Yeah. Me and my father were talking about that. Exactly. Yeah, if you hit them in the pocket, you get it. But we scared. Cause see, like for the NFL, and I know a lot of people. I don't know about you. Black people just would refuse to give up sports. Mm-hmm. Like I'm like, can we come together for some fucking thing? We had a boycott, but I think the real boycott should have been if every black player in the NFL just didn't show up one Sunday to the game.
That's the only way it happens.
One Sunday,
because here's the thing.
My daddy said that, and I was like, damn, that makes a lot of sense.
It does, because. Us boycotting doesn't mean shit.
Nope.
Here's why it doesn't mean shit. If you look at how, and if I'm 95% sure I'm right about this, but if I'm not, please somebody let me know. Viewership and contractually speaking, the NFL has already gotten paid by the advertisers.
Yeah.
Up through, I think it was like 2024. Excuse me. At the time. That Brother Kaepernick was kicking this shit off. He was kicking stress to the NFL. So, NFL, we need to understand something. White people don't give a fuck about us. All right, they don't care about our plight. They don't care about All right. They don't care. And that's all right that they don't care. I'm perfectly okay with the fact that they don't care because it's not meant for them to care. All right. It's just not meant for them to care. This wasn't built for them to care about us.
True. You know? So why are we, this is nothing that plagues us. Okay. Now this is good. This will be our final point. Why are we so gung ho on being unified? Not with each other, but with them.
I don't know. I don't agree with that. We're trying to be unified with them.
You don't think so?
No.
Wait. You don't know anybody that says that?
No. That we need to be unified with white people?
Yes.
No.
What?
No. I think. I haven't.
Well, I need to hang around the people you hang around with. But yeah. not that I hang around these people, but know the people you know. Because I've been told that. Yeah. Why can't we all just be one together?
Yeah. Okay. I have seen that. That's fair.
They never say that. We say it.
This is true. And the thing is, I was talking to a coworker one day, and he's as white as the Xerox paper, and I told him personally for me, it's not anything against white people,
right?
But it is 100% against white supremacy and everything that it represents. And within white supremacy, all right, that system obviously is not built to give a fuck about us. So until we do things, I hate to quantify another man's dollar, another person's dollar. And so it sounds good that, oh, if all the players didn't show up, but I get it.
Just one Sunday.
But I get it. Like, those players, They have a family. They have this. They have that.
Right.
But at the same time,
but they also have money in the bank.
This is true. And
at least they should.
And Muhammad Ali. You know, back in those days, back during those civil rights days, 50 years ago, those athletes, they had shit to lose too.
Yeah.
You know?
But Muhammad Ali wasn't scared.
No, he wasn't scared.
See, that's the problem.
Man.
He wasn't afraid.
He wasn't scared
because
he could physically beat you up.
Right.
Mentally beat you up.
Right. And he wasn't afraid of shit. He would tell him, hell no, I'm not going to serve.
Yes.
No, I'm not doing this. No, I'm not doing that.
But, and so that is, we showed, the thing is, here's my point. We would not as a people be taken seriously because we're never on one accord. It's always dissension between our ranks. Always. And the dissension in our ranks occurs at the point where it matters the most. Like, we're going to have dissension. This is a fact. We're talking about the 70% solution. We're not going to be 100%. Got it. But the percentile of where we need to be together in order to hit pockets. Mm-hmm. We're never together. We're never there. And that's the problem. And
we're not there because we're afraid.
Politically, it happens.
Yeah.
You know, we've been getting fucked over politically time and time again by the Democrats over and over and over and over again. But no one says to these candidates, man, fuck you, dog. Like, no. It's not happening. What happened with President Trump and the HBCU over there. we allow that to happen. Like, educationally.
I can't even call him that.
Look, we can't get on our own shit.
Right.
So why would they respect? Why would this system respect anything that we have going on?
That's a great question. And I think we're going to take it. I'm going to end right here.
Absolutely.
For now, because the next time you're in town, I would like for you to come back.
Brother, anything. I appreciate you entertaining my little raggedy ass. Okay. Good people. We definitely appreciate you. Thank you for having me. Give me a shout. Instagram @ I am Coop C. If you have a problem with anything that I have said today, I respectfully say fuck you and fight me. Come see about me. But and if you do come see about me, bring libations. That's just rude if you don't. Okay, this is
we can discuss it over drinks.
Absolutely. I'll bring the cups.
And invite me over. I'll bring the ice.
Yeah, bring the ice. It's a team effort. See, look at that. Black people are progressing already. Teamwork.
Ah, teamwork makes the dream work.
It makes the dream work.
Well, I want to thank my guest, Coop C, for coming in and sharing his knowledge and wisdom with us. And I'll see you good people next week for another show of Talkin' Shit with Kire. Y'all be easy. Have a great week. Stay up.